Now that we're done with the morning particulars, I always love when they talk about how Google is going to give away a Google Home. And I know it's just a little like Amazon thingy, but it always I think, are they going to build me a house somewhere? It'll have Google Fiber, and everything's automatic, and this futuristic car that drives itself, that's a Google Home. So if there's anybody here from Google, tell them the challenge is on the table. If you want to give away something cool, that's what you want to give away. That'll get people attracted. So I welcome everybody in. It is 8 o'clock on a Thursday morning. My name is Mark Sachs. Actually, if you're in here at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, I don't know if I'll have much respect for you because tonight's the big bash and you really should be there, which makes it very hard for speakers tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock. But I know some people will be here at eight, so it's all good and there will be more going on. What I'm going to talk to you about this morning is the power grid and what we do to secure it. So my role is the Chief Security Officer at NERC, the North American Electric Reliability Corporation. We are a nonprofit. We're headquartered in Atlanta, Georgia, with an office in Washington, D.C., where I work. Our roots go back to the 1960s. Does everybody remember or at least be aware of the 1965 power outage that affected New York City? Okay, so that was like our little come to the altar moment. Because up to that point, the power grid had been working quite well. World War II was, 20 years behind us, and we're the big, mighty industrial United States. And something that should never happen happened in 1965 when the lights go out. And that caused a lot of people to really get concerned about why did it happen and what can we do to prevent this from ever happening again. So a few years after that, the original NERC, which was just formed as a council of energy operators to get together and pool resources, got started in 1968. And for the next several decades, everything was fine. Well, we had some little outages here and there. You get lightning strikes, you get ice storms, those happen. But the big deal, of course, was August of 2003, the big blackout. In the United States, we call it the Northeast Power Blackout. If you're from Canada, you call it the Southeast Power Blackout. But everybody knows what we're talking about. It's that thing that happened in August of 2003. And when it first happened, that was the same week that the blaster worm was going around. So if you were in InfoSec in those days, you remember blaster. Everybody's trying to draw this conclusion that blaster caused the lights to go out, which wasn't the case. It was just tree trimming was wrong in Ohio, some lines drooping and arced to ground, and it starts a cascading failure. The good news, though, is the safety systems all kicked in. And as the power went out, it stopped, it isolated like it's supposed to, and within a few hours, we're resetting breakers and getting everything back up and running again, and lights are back on. So good news from that, but the question goes around, why? Why did this happen, and what can we do to prevent it from happening again? Because we don't want that. We want reliable power. We understand that the thing that underlies our economy is electric power. So the hearings were held, of course Congress has to be involved. And about 2006 or so, an Energy Act was passed, or 2005 I think is when it was passed, but it creates this new organization, an Electricity Reliability Organization, or ERO. The question at the time was, should that be a governmental function? Should that belong to the Department of Energy or to FERC, the regulators, or the new Department of Homeland Security was there at the time? Or should it be the private sector? And in the end, NERC, who of course had been around since the 1960s, was selected to be the ERO, the Electricity Reliability Organization. So this is when we got started on what's called the SIP standards. Many of you are probably very familiar with the Critical Infrastructure Protection, or CIP, SIP standards. We're on the fifth version of those standards now as we continue to evolve and learn how they work. Those are all put into place to make sure we don't ever have a 2003 blackout, or a 1965 blackout, or any other future blackout. And I think that the record speaks for itself. We've done quite well. There have been outages. Yes, they are distribution outages. These happen all the time, generally because of storms, or because something bad happens. Somebody runs a truck into a power pole. You'll have local outages. You can't really stop those unless you bury all the lines, and that's very, very expensive. But I think, again, the record speaks for itself. But what I want to talk to you today, just a quick little overview, kind of how the power grid works, just so everybody gets a basic sense of what we're up against. And then I want to focus in on all the challenges we face, all the security issues that come against the grid, so that you have kind of a full spectrum of what we're fighting. And at the end, I'll use the case study. You've probably already heard a few speakers talk about it this week, having to do with what happened in Ukraine a little over a year ago, and how that might implicate us here in the United States and Canada. And then we'll take a couple of questions, and we'll be finished. So our grid, if you think about the critical infrastructure of North America, everybody depends on the cyber networks, of course, fiber optic networks, computer centers, data centers, and so forth. But that infrastructure, the fiber, copper, everything that's underneath, also depends on electricity. And I think you could probably make the argument that both communications, like the cyber infrastructure, and electricity are your two common denominators that we all depend on. But electricity is even more of a common denominator even. So the comms companies, they can work on generators or batteries for a while, but they're very dependent on the grid to keep them going. By the way, the grid is very dependent on the comms companies. So we interchange a lot of our information and a lot of sharing that's happening there. Well, the concept of an energy grid goes back to roughly World War II. Electricity, if you've studied your histories, back to the late 1800s when Westinghouse and Edison and Tesla even and others were kind of trying to figure out how do we do something with this newfound tool called electricity that we can generate with spinning things and with batteries and so forth. Is there a way to generate and distribute the volts that we're able to create? And early on, most of energy was created and consumed locally. So you naturally had water power. This has been around for millennial. I mean, this goes back to the Greeks and before, understanding how to harness water. So it was natural to harness water to start generating electricity. And if you were fortunate enough to be next to a dam or a water feature or something where we could harness the power of water, you could have electricity. Of course, steam was around in the 1800s, so creating steam turbines was very common, gas, other things. But really what was going on was electricity was created, distributed, and consumed very local. Following roughly World War II, the idea of let's spread this stuff out, because oftentimes where we generate is more economical to put it away from where the people are. So you build these big, huge dams, you know, the Hoover Dam, the Cooley Dam, things like that. You don't want to live around that area, but it can generate gazillions of watts of power. So I need to transmit that power someplace else. And this is why you see today across North America all these transmission lines that run everywhere. So we'll generate power. And if you think about nuclear power even that's come of age, you don't want to have your nuclear power plant downtown somewhere. You want to be far, far away, you know, just in case. Although bad will never happen, but just in case. You want to keep it far, far away. But you got to get that power to where people live. As the years went by, we recognized that interconnecting these systems brings lots of efficiencies. So today we have this big grid where we generate power where it's cheap to generate it. We transmit power at your transmission lines down to your local utilities, who then distribute the power to your home, your businesses, your offices, to the Moscone Center, et cetera. So, you know, these lights that are shining at me right now, the lights that are overhead, where are those volts coming from? I couldn't tell you. There's a generator out there somewhere in California that are all working together, and one little volt comes from one and one comes from someplace else. Who knows? Who cares? The idea is it works. In fact, some of those volts may be coming from Canada. Don't know. Someday they might even be coming from Mexico. It doesn't matter, as long as it all works. Well, the power grid that we've built across North America is in two major parts. And by the way, sir, you're welcome to take pictures, but these slides will be available to you later. So knock yourself out if you like, but you'll all get copies of these through RSA. Two major grids, what we call an Eastern Interconnect and a Western Interconnect, and then little minor areas. Let me just flip over and kind of show you what this looks like on a map. So you can see how the eastern half of North America is in one big chunk, and you have Quebec sitting up there by themselves, you have Texas by themselves, and you have the western part of North America. These interconnections are all synchronized, and what I'm talking about there is the frequency of power in North America is 60 cycles per second, or 60 hertz. In Europe and in other areas of the world, it's at 50 cycles or 50 hertz. Those decisions were made long, long time ago. There was a big battle over whether 50 cycles or 60 cycles was more efficient. Is 110 or 220 more efficient for delivery? Long time ago, electrical engineers figured this stuff out. We are stuck with those decisions made long, long time ago. I don't think we will ever get off of 110, 60 cycles here in North America any more than Europe will ever get off of 220, 50. That's just going to be that way. But that, when we look at that Eastern Interconnect, the takeaway is that if I generate power down in Florida, those spinning turbines are precisely in sync with spinning turbines up in Ohio or up in Ottawa. Anywhere inside that interconnect, they are all locked together, spinning in sequence or in sync with each other. That, my friends, is an amazing feat of engineering, that we've been able to build a machine that big, that covers that large of a geographic area, that is totally running together. Can you imagine the engineering it's taken to do that? And we often take all this for granted. The lights are on. This is awesome. Flip a switch, flip off a switch, flip a switch. And don't think about the miracles of what's happening behind the scenes. That same frequency stuff happens on the Western Interconnect, Texas Interconnect, and so forth. Now, we can move power between these interconnections using direct current or DC ties, as we like to call them, but we keep the frequency separations apart. They may be exactly lined up, but it's not important for them to be lined up. What we want to do is manage that frequency on the inside. So inside of our world, inside of NERC, we've kind of got a hierarchy with NERC up at the top, and then we divide up the footprint, as it were, the North America. Now, I keep talking about North America, so this is United States, Canada, and you see that little piece of Mexico that's right below San Diego that's in Baja, so they are interconnected with California. So we include that little piece of Mexico inside of our footprint. We may actually add the rest of Mexico in the next few years. There's been a lot of discussion with the Mexican government about bringing their grid up to NERC standards, making it its own interconnect perhaps, you know, running and balancing Mexico just like we do with Quebec or Texas or something, but being part of the North American footprint for NERC. So stay tuned on that one. That may actually happen in the next few years. But these reliability coordinators working with us, with NERC, their role is to make sure that the standards are followed, that we enforce things, that all the stuff we've been putting together, the SIP standards since 2006, are actually in place. Well, that's all regulatory. Now, let me talk a little bit about the electrical engineering side of it without giving a deep class on EE. Think about on the left side, we generate power in an area, like one of those little regions. We may also bring power in. Remember I was talking about there's some DC interconnections, and you might even have, you know, an area, say the state of Virginia, run by Dominion Power, might actually buy power from a generator that's outside of their footprint, so they're importing power, say from Pennsylvania or somewhere. So anyway, on the left, you have the power you create and anything that you might bring in. It has to balance, electrical engineering-wise, those megawatts of power that you're creating or buying has to balance with the demand, your customer demand, what you're getting rid of in terms of exporting, and also just losses. You know, there's regular electrical engineering theory will tell you there's going to be friction loss inside the wires and other places lost is heat. That has to balance exactly. If it balances properly, the frequencies will line up at 60 hertz. And this is a little fun thing about electrical engineering. If it starts to, we start creating more power than there is demand, the frequency will actually go up. And you can measure this. Anybody, you can do this at home. You can measure the frequency of your little 110 outlets. There's a lapse that'll do this for you. And you can watch and see. It should hit on 60.00000, but usually it wiggles a little bit, plus or minus 0.001 or so, because generation and demand are not always perfectly balanced. Yeah, you think about it, this is realistic. When I turn on these bright lights here, nobody in the state of California knew that I was about to turn them on so they can synchronize the generators to speed up just a little bit when I turn the lights on. So as soon as I turn it on, I increase my demand, which means it's actually gonna lower the frequency by just the smallest amount, but immediately the generation side picks up on it, starts generating the power that's needed, and it goes right back to 60 hertz again. As soon as I turn off my lights, there's a couple of milliseconds there where the frequency will go a little higher than 60, the generator will pick up on it, drops it back down. Does that sort of make sense? It's really cool when you think about it. That's part of that big machine. Well, to make all that work, we have to have what are called balancing authorities. Each of those little white dots there across North America, these are private companies that run computers and control systems that are managing exactly what I'm talking about, making sure those 60-cycle standard stays put. We do a lot of monitoring of this world, and it's kind of interesting because we can actually see ahead of time if generators are having mechanical issues. So if a particular generator is spinning a little slow, it's not able to catch up to the load real quick, that might mean that a bearing is about to go out or that there's some other mechanical issue. So we can even use this predictably to help with maintenance and other types of reliability things. We can see if transmission lines aren't able to properly handle the load. We can see this ahead of time and call for repair work. So this type of insight into how the grid mechanically works is absolutely fascinating. And if you're looking for a really cool area to get into research-wise, this is fun stuff. I mean, there's a lot of really neat data there. So if I put all this together in terms of a picture, this is what our high-level grid would look like, 345,000 volts, all the way up to about 1,000,000 volts in some of the lines. Granted, there is a lot more to the grid than this that's lower in voltage, but just your high voltage lines. a problem we face, of course. These are big, obnoxious scars across the landscape. You know, right of way that's hundreds of feet wide, big steel towers, ugly wires. Not in my backyard, NIMBY, you know, as people say. But yet they want their lights to be turned on. And so it's like, well, how am I going to get this power to you if you won't let us run these things? You'll often see on the transmission corridors, if you look today, where you have a series of towers that used to be just three cables or three wires. Now you'll have where the insulators are hanging down, there'll actually be two or maybe three or maybe four cables all hanging underneath the same insulator. Have you noticed that? So all we're doing there is instead of building new towers, we're just increasing the transmission capability by running another wire. Now, why do you have three wires? Because there's three phases in the 60-cycle world. Again, a little electrical engineering, 360-degree circle, 120 degrees, 120 degrees, 120 degrees, three phases, 120 degrees off from each other, all in sync. Each of those wires carrying essentially one-third of the power through that transmission corridor. But we can add capacity just by putting in more wires. The steel towers naturally have to be engineered to hold that weight. And if we have to add more wire, well, at some point we have to build bigger towers. And that's essentially what's going on behind the scenes. So let me shift gear a little bit now, talk about the electronic side of it. This is the piece that really scares a lot of people, because while we understand the physics of the grid and the spinning generators and the wires and all that, no human can get their head into how this actually works. So over the years, we've been letting computers get involved. And it sort of makes sense. I want to transfer human decision-making to a computer and let it help me understand what's going on. So there's lots of devices. I've got a few of them up here, some terminologies and things. There's, you know, classes that last for weeks or months that go through all the details of how these little devices work. But the takeaway I want you to think about is that in the early days of control, it was often a small box that had power. It, you know, in other words, it's got its own little 110-volt circuit that's providing it with juice, maybe a little transformer that steps it down to 12 volts. But it's just sitting there and listening and monitoring. And if it needed to make a decision, it was a mechanical decision. A little relay would just flip on or flip off and cause something to happen. You could also have a controller that might have a response mechanism that comes back. You remember RS-232, the old serial connections? So could communicate back to a controller over a serial line, or RS-422, I think, was another standard. There were several that were out there. Well, with the advent of computer networking, and particularly the lowering of the cost of Ethernet, and now, of course, wireless Wi-Fi, there's been this huge demand to start moving these devices from being just little dumb sensors that might use a serial connection to send telemetry back, to let's make them extremely smart, intelligent, IEDs as we like to call them, intelligent electronic devices. And so we populate our grid with those little things, and they can all sit out there and tell the humans what's going on. But of course, they're using Ethernet and TCP/IP and all this stuff to talk. And so what's the next natural temptation? Let's let them talk over the internet, because it's free and it's everywhere and we love to do this. And can you see the problem? Yeah, the internet's totally safe, right? There's no vulnerabilities, there's no threats, there's nobody out there that's trying to do anything bad. So if you look at the inside of a modern substation today, automation-wise, this is just a school book kind of example. They're all built, each one luckily is built a little different. But you can see those intelligent devices down there along the bottom doing their sensor, and they might be electrically connected to some little gatherer over a serial port, or they might use Ethernet, or they might use wireless, but ultimately it's all going up to little workstations where humans can interact with what's going on. Therein lies another vulnerability. That human sitting at that workstation, if the workstation's isolated and only talks to the substation, that's fine, but how many humans want to have a single computer for this purpose, a single computer for this purpose, and another computer for this purpose? Well, let's just push them all together, and that way I can check my Facebook while I'm making sure that the grid is balanced, you know, that kind of thing. And you can see the problem there, because now you have a human angle where all of you are Homer Simpson fans, you know, sitting in front of the keyboard. He's the safety engineer at Springfield Nuclear Power Plant, but he also likes to, you know, check up on Lisa and his wife and stuff. And you can see the issue. The human oftentimes becomes the weak link, not the electronics. Humans making human types of error. At a much larger level, you'll see this across the country, these big, large control rooms. They're fascinating to go into, big map of whatever the area is that they're controlling. A lot of that's kind of eye candy. Those big maps are for when visitors come in, because the engineers don't just sit back there, you know, stroking their little gray beards. Ah, look, that alarm just went off. We need to roll a truck and go turn those bolts back on. Now, that's generally not the way it works. But if there is a major problem, if you're having big outages, it does help the human mind to see what everything's looking like in near real time. If you've never been to one of these, please try and go. They're absolutely fascinating to see what's going on. By the way, it's not just electricity. Gas and oil does this, communications does this, railroads, airlines. Anybody who runs large infrastructures that have a physical type of footprint will have these types of control rooms. And they are definitely worth going to visit and try and understand what's happening. But please keep in mind, those with the long screwdrivers who can affect things, don't look at those big maps. That's just there for you to see as a visitor, or for senior leaders to get their situation awareness from. So I want to throw a little diagram up here, and I see my friends from EEI over here smiling because they know where I'm going with this. There was a request made to one of the consulting firms in Washington a couple of years ago, said, could you build me a landscape of the types of threats we might see against the power sector? And this is what they came back with. And it's a very interesting landscape map. It shows threats in terms of their likelihood going up the left of the y-axis, and what bad could happen, consequences along the horizontal or the x-axis. Can you make out the icon in the upper left-hand corner? I know some of you on the front row can probably see that. You see what that is? What is it, sir? A squirrel. Okay. Could a squirrel cause the power grid to collapse? The power grid. No. Could a squirrel cause the lights to go out at your house? Oh, without a doubt, yeah. Very low consequence, but very high probability. And in fact, every day, somebody somewhere, if it's not a squirrel, it's a snake or a bird or some critter gets into somebody's substation or a transformer hanging outside your house or whatever and commences to chew and nibble. And I'm going to show you some gross pictures here in just a second. And they turn the lights off. But am I worried about that as a security event? No, that's just an inconvenience kind of problem. Bottom right-hand corner, low probability, high consequence. What is that symbol? Yeah, it looks to me like nuclear warfare. Oh, my God. Okay, am I going to nuclear-proof all my transmission lines and nuclear-proof all my substations? I mean, if Armageddon comes and the electricity grid survives and everything else is gone, well, that's awesome. We have this really cool power grid that survived and everything else is gone. So what I like to do when I see charts like this is, can I kind of maybe put it into who has the biggest role? And I would argue that those things on the bottom right that have a very low probability, but they're existential events, kind of keeping them from happening is more of a public sector. Figure government, military, and others. That's kind of their world. Not saying the private sector doesn't have a role, but mitigating and prevention is kind of down there. Upper left, squirrels. Yeah, that's my problem. That's private sector. We got that one. Thank you, Uncle Sam. You don't need to go out and hunt squirrels. We'll take care of that end of it. And roughly, things that are in the middle are kind of a joint shared effort. That's just a rough picture of where we put things. But I think it wants to bring stuff in perspective. There are existential events, nuclear warfare, chemical warfare, things like that, that the private sector really can't defend against. We have the government and the military to do that. There are convenience events like squirrel attacks that I think we should just let the private sector worry about, and everything else that's in between. So let me show you some pictures. There is a website out there called Cyber Squirrel One. They've been around for a couple of years, and they've been tracking the number of secret agents that have been going after the power grid, you know, trying to find that elusive cyber attack. And of course, their count, you can see the squirrels are far, far ahead. This little screenshot I took about 2 weeks ago in order to hit the RSA deadlines for submissions. But at that point, they had tracked up so far, it was 879 squirrel attacks that successfully caused power outages. And you can see birds and snakes and raccoons and as it makes it down. Down at the bottom, you see there's three humans. They're giving credit to the drinking term Stuxnet. You know, every time you hear that term, you're supposed to drink. So that's one of the ones they're giving credit to. They're giving credit to the Ukraine events that happened in December a couple of years ago, which I'll talk about briefly in a second. And what was the thought? I'll think of the third one in a second. There's a third one they're saying is a human thing. But what you're looking at that image, by the way, that is an owl that was going after a dead squirrel. So the squirrel died first. the owl saw the dead squirrel up on top, and you can see the remains of one of the squirrel's legs all the way up top. You see where it's still kind of attached to that wire? And when the owl separated the squirrel from his leg, the owl got electrocuted. You can see the rest of the squirrel is still in the owl's talons as he's now stuck to the pole. So a lineman has to go up there with a shovel, you know, literally peel the owl off and then reset breakers to get the power back on. Folks, this is normal. This is the types of attacks we see all the time on our networks. Let me show you some other ones that we see all the time. Interesting image here. You know, you can see up top, I say it's a lightning strike. When we were warned about this happened in Arizona. The owners of this transmission line, one morning when they're out driving it, they see what they thought was somebody trying to blow up a tower. You know, literally the concrete at the base of the tower leg had exploded. They call in the FBI, local law enforcement. They tape off the area. They're investigating it as a criminal act. Called us. We start investigating. Threw these pictures up through our ISAC, the Information Sharing Analysis Center, and very quickly we get a phone call back from somebody who says, that looks awful like a lightning strike. In other words, improperly grounded. It went into the concrete and exploded. Got with the National Weather Service, pulled up the lightning maps, and sure enough, overnight, right at that site, the lightning map showed several lightning strikes. So immediately we were able to call, you know, stand down law enforcement. But you can see how at first you might think this is somebody trying to physically damage a tower, when in fact it's really just lightning doing what lightning does. Oftentimes the weather gets in the way. You can see on the right the top of a tower that's bent over because it had too much wind loading on it, just couldn't handle the wind, over it comes. And over on the left, this is in Louisiana last summer when they're having all the heavy flooding. You see that poor guy down there with that big safety stick trying to hit a breaker and the water's like up to his chin? My God, I hope his insurance policy is up to date. How many of you would stand out there in water up to your chin, you know, trying to do what you're supposed to do? Sometimes we get fires in substations. Transformers, as you can imagine, very, very hot. They're filled with oil. And if they catch on fire, lights can go out. This was in Puerto Rico last fall. Every now and then we get other little interesting things. You ever seen a pipe bomb before? Now you know what one looks like. So this is in a generation facility, a couple of pipe bombs that appeared, again, recording off all the area. As the investigation ensued, it turns out these are not real pipe bombs, they're fake pipe bombs, and they were put there as a practical joke against some new employee. Yeah, okay, well obviously the practical jokers are no longer working for the power company, and the new employee probably is working at Wendy's now. But you can see this is the kind of stupidity we're up against, as well as the reality, what if they really were pipe bombs? What if we really had to go in and defuse them? Now, this is reality. Here's another type of IED. I was talking about the intelligent electronic devices. How about an improved explosive device? What you're seeing on the left is thermite inside of little containers that some Yahoo had tried to shoot up over some transmission lines, hoping that as one of the containers went over the transmission line on a long metal filament, that when it wrapped around the wire, that's what he was hoping for, with the thermite on the end of it, the other end would arc to ground, which would explode the thermite, which would then cut the wires. This is what was in the goofball's head. All that wound up happening is it created a grass fire. Fire department goes out there to put out the grass fire, and they find these things. And we start investigating, and ultimately they arrested some little fellow who's been causing trouble, and he's a known wacko. But that's real world. Again, people trying to do disruptive things against us. This is a transformer that was shot with a high-powered deer rifle, and all its oil comes out. And you can see, of course, most of your transformer facilities have these little dikes around just for this kind of thing. If it's going to leak the oil, at least we can contain the oil so you don't have an environmental case as well. But we're talking about a distribution substation here that loses power for several days until they can patch the hole, refill it with oil, get it restarted. Local customers hanging off of this power distribution substation, of course, lose power until they can repair it. Luckily, it's not a transmission substation, it was a distribution. But again, a human-caused security event. We have lots of breaking in, people that'll cut through the fence to steal copper. Now, if the copper's energized, Darwin's rule comes into effect. And that thief doesn't, you know, is taken out of the gene pool and we don't have to worry about them again. But if it's a spool of copper laying there that's easy to steal, they can take it off and go resell it. Copper theft is probably one of our biggest intrusion events when people try and break into substations. That's what they're going after, something they can steal and resell. Now, I've been asked to take pictures of cyber events. This is the closest I can get to a cyber type of problem. And here you have a black bear who thinks there's a morning snack, a little Scooby snack, all the way up at the top where that nest sits. So he climbs a tower, or she climbs a tower, goes up, has their morning snack, and climbs back down. No bears were hurt. Power stayed on. But folks, you're kind of getting the point here. The threats to the grid. Yeah, we might have a mouse click here and there, but the real threats is Mother Nature. It's animals, it's squirrels, it's snakes, it's bears, it's humans that are doing stupid things, shooting at stuff. This happens all the time. And we have built resiliency in the grid to counteract this type of behavior. So if we get into a cyber situation, the same resiliency, the same countermeasures that are built to resist the daily onslaught we have against the grid will also kick in. And we'll protect the grid so we can restore it within minutes just to get it back up and run again. So let me shift a little bit now and talk about cyber threats. And then let me remove a little confusion, but also show you some of the reality. Has anybody ever seen this type of screen in their enterprise? Do you know what it means? What just happened here? Ransomware, yeah. Oh my God, oh dear. You don't want to see this except on a PowerPoint slideshow outside of RSA. You don't ever want to see this on your screen because it means you've just had something crypto locked on you. Now you're going to have to deal with some ransomware person. Or if you've done the right thing and you've got everything backed up properly, you can just restore from backup. If this happens inside of a power company, it might happen on the enterprise side. That doesn't stop the volts from flowing. Remember, electricity is physical in nature. There's big spinning things that have inertia. Volts will continue to flow. Even if the control systems get affected, volts continue to flow. They will fail into a known state, and we send an engineer out and take manual control of it. So we can't really hack the power grid via a ransomware attack and cause volts to stop. That's not really technically possible, but it makes for a great Tom Clancy book or a really cool Die Hard 4 or, you know, all the movies that we like to see about it. But let me show you something real. Anybody here speak Russian? Let's just assume nobody does. Over on the left is an email that appears to come from the government of Ukraine in March of 2015. It's written in Russian, goes to a bunch of power companies. And I'm not sure what it says in Russian, but essentially it says attached is this spreadsheet and you need to open the spreadsheet. What should most people do when you receive such an email that says, please open the attachment? Yeah, I mean, just natively it ought to be. No clicking, go away, you know, hit delete or whatever. Well, if you open the attachment, Microsoft Office opens, again, Russian background, all that, a nice little infected Excel spreadsheet that takes advantage of something inside of Microsoft, puts a little backdoor onto your computer. This is what happened 9 months before, and this is the actual event here, because we went back and we found it in the logs, the actual email that started a chain of events that led to the Ukrainian power problem in December of 2015. So 9 months earlier, it starts as a fishing expedition with an attachment. And all it takes is one person to open that attachment. Now you have a toehold. And what the intruders found once they got in and was able to kind of root around is that usernames and passwords were in common everywhere. And so one engineer's username and password is replicated in several places. Oh, well, why don't I just try remotely logging in and use those same credentials and see if they work? Ding, ding, it works. You see all the mistakes here that are being made? So we have a human in the loop making human problems, and it's the crime folks that figure it out. So this is how it manifests itself. 9 months later, this Oblenergo, or energy company in Ukraine, throws up on their website this, and this is actually in English, and I have to applaud this Oblenergo. Within an hour or two of the lights going out, they throw something up on their website that says, ooh, there's an issue here, we're aware of it, we're working on it, we are going to restore it for you. And in their broken English, they say that there has been an event, what was the words that they use? I can't read it from here, it's too far away from me from here. Let me step over here. Third parties were made illegal entry into information technological system of remote access to equipment telecontrol substations. What they're trying to say is intruders came in through remote access and turned off our lights. So they're aware of it. And kudos to them for immediately telling their customers what's going on. Imagine the culture here in North America. How many of them would put up on their website within an hour or so, oh my God, we've had a little cyber problem. Everybody's so scared to say anything because they might become, you know, an example or worse. So we investigated. This is what Ukraine looks like. You probably have sat through a few Ukraine briefings, but their grid is not unlike anybody else's grid. There's a major east-west kind of backbone. What makes Ukraine a little unique is to their right or to the east is Russia, and they are interconnected with Russia. Remember the balancing and the frequencies and all that I was talking about earlier? So they remain synchronous with Russia. Why? Well, that's the old Soviet Union. They haven't completely separated the infrastructures yet. All the engineers speak Russian. All the equipment is old Soviet Russian, the mindset, the ways of doing things. And virtually all the little utilities there all do it the same way. That's a normal old Soviet model. We all do this the same way. It's the right way. We do it the same way. Here in North America, we encourage diversity. No two substations are the same. No two companies run their infrastructures the same. Diversity is all over the place here. In Ukraine, it's homogeneous. So if you make a mistake in one place, you can probably find that mistake being made elsewhere. And that's another problem. That thing about reusing passwords, remote access, affected three of the utilities. Same problem being in three different parts of Ukraine. So there are 23 of these utilities. Four of them were attacked in December of 2015. Only three actually worked because the fourth orb, Lanergo, had actually read an alert that said, watch out for attacks coming in through remote systems and be sure that you properly protect your remote login. They did that, and they avoided this thing. The other three didn't happen. So what they did right, that fourth group, is they paid attention to their local CERT, the Computer Emergency Response Team. Here in the United States, we have US CERT. Of course, there's CERT-CC, and there's the ISACs. We're all trying to work together to make sure that the owner-operator community is fully informed of these types of vulnerabilities and these alerts. In fact, we at the Electricity ISAC sent a team over to Ukraine to learn about what happened so that we could inform our own utilities here in the United States and in Canada the exact technical details so they could go back and check and make sure that none of us were sitting ducks for this type of an attack. It was very, very informative. As I've been talking about earlier, 9 months before the event, all the way back in March, you saw that email, that spear phishing, is what started this chain of events. There was, by the way, physical attacks. Keep in mind that there are parts of Ukraine that are contested, the Crimea area, you know, that adjoins Russia, contested space. There is physical warfare that's going on. At first, when we heard about power outages in Ukraine, we thought it was just that kind of stuff, you know, people blowing things up. Then we come to find out, no, this was over in Western Ukraine. This is the part of Ukraine that's not contested with Russia. And so, you know, it's a little different scenario for them actually trying to blow things up. But it was that credential harvesting was the weak link that led to the intrusion. If you'd like to read more about this over at the ISAC, we did a complete analysis. We published it at what we call TLP White, the traffic light protocol, color white, meaning anybody can read this thing. Published back in March, it's still available on our website. Interestingly, though, we track who downloads our documents, as you can imagine. Within minutes of us making this thing public, where do the first downloads come from? Russia, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, they monitor us just as much as we monitor them. China was right behind them in terms of downloading the document. It took a little while for the word to get out across North America as the utilities start downloading, but it was very interesting to see that those initial downloads are coming from Russia and China. Ultimately, all the countries around the world have been downloading this, so please feel free, download it. Your adversaries have copies of it, so you may as well be reading it as well and learn everything that they learn. So inside our document and in the education process we've been putting out, working closely with the utilities, we've got lots of things that we've been laying out. Everybody's very familiar with the top 20 controls, the SANS 20. If they had followed the first four or five of them, this would not have happened. So those controls work. And it's not just in electricity. Wherever you are, those basic controls work. You just have to do them. The NIST framework, you know, starting off with identifying your assets, they didn't know that they had passwords reproduced. They didn't know in some cases there was remote access. If you don't know what you're protecting, you can't protect it. So those basic things, if everybody was doing that, the whole temperature would come down. The cyber problem would not be the big deal it is today if we would just follow the basic stuff. Last thing, we're all familiar with IoT, Internet of Things. This is kind of like the new emerging problem. It's not so much the connected devices inside the power grids, it's those connected devices inside your homes that's the concern. where folks have their thermostats and their cameras and their microwave ovens and whatever else connected to your home network, and you've got your default passwords, admin, or whatever it is, and you've never bothered to change it. Those little things gang up and become a threat problem. How many of you use Shodan to check your networks? A couple of you, please do this. It's a free service. They've already checked you. If you go to Shodan and you type in your IP address or your domain name, they have already done the research. It's not like they're about to scan you. It's already there. And your adversaries are already looking at it. So please, other tools are out there that are like that. So RSA always asks me to put up a, here's what you need to take away from this thing. So you've probably seen these slides before. So make sure that you identify, if you're dependent on power, which I hope you are, that you know exactly which utility provides you with your volts. Where is that substation? Where is it actually coming from? And make sure you have a good relationship with your power company. If you have a need for quick restoration, make sure they know that and why. Look at your own control systems. Make sure you're following those basic rules. You don't want to be the next Ukraine. You don't want to be the headlines in the Washington Post or the Journal or some other place. And in the coming months, make sure that you've got your own business continuity plans, that if bad happens, if the power goes down, how do you continue doing business, regardless of whether it's a squirrel that did it or if it's a mouse click that did it, or nuclear warfare, whatever. What are your plans to continue? And I won't read the rest of those, but you can do that yourself. I've got a couple of minutes left. There is a couple of microphones here. If anybody has any questions, feel free to step up to the mic as I start winding things up. But you can go to the ISAC website, www.eisac.com. Even if you're not in the electricity sector, you can download a lot of these how-to guides or the thing from Ukraine and other analysis. If you are in the electricity sector, if you work for a power company, you probably already have an account here and should be checking it routinely. We put out a lot of information daily about what's going on inside the power grid. We are going to be expanding later this year to allow vendors and consultants and others to start coming into the family. But keep in mind that any information that's shared with us is the property of whoever shares it. And if that entity sharing wants everybody to know, they'll tell us that we can share broadly. If they only want other asset owners to know, that's as far as it goes. So we, as you can imagine, get frequent requests from the government and from others, please tell me what's going on here. And we'll say, well, that entity doesn't want you to know. Yes, sir, I think we have 1 minute, so let's make it quick. Close to the mic so I can hear you.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. I just was wondering, do you have any automated strut exchange, like sticks or taxi?
Yes, we do.
And so do you validate your IOCs?
So here's what we've done. That's a very good question. So sticks and taxi, and of course, I'm sure there's been plenty of talks on that, the structured format for moving information around. We have, working with Threat Connect and with other similar vendors, we, inside the power sector, do indicator exchange. The validation is from the submitter, so the utility. We're not looking to the government to tell us what's going on. So I'll have an energy company that picks up on something. They assert, they own the assertion that this is a problem and put it into Threat Connect or into this exchange. Others then, depending on the reliability and credibility of that organization, can make their own decision as to what you do with it. We try not to just go out and pull anything we can find and throw it in because we can't validate. Wonderful question. Yes, ma'am, we'll take one more and I know I have to stop.
Can you talk to the extent that the NERC SIPs apply to electrical construction contractors or engineering firms?
So the SIP standards only apply to what we call the registered entities, so the actual producers and distributor or transmitters of electricity. They are the ones that are subject to the standards, but those contractors, providers have to build to those standards. But the standards don't apply to the contractor companies, it's to the power company. Okay? Thanks very much, folks. Enjoy the rest of your day. See you around. Thank you.